Good evening. I'm Councilmember Ben Kallos. Thank you for joining us for this bike safety program results forum. I know it's the middle of the summer, but I will tell you that we did a whole bunch of these forums last year, and month after month, June, July, August, we had 50 to 100 people coming out with their concerns. One of the things I started to learn in this job is if you tell the same number of people, in fact, I think we've told three times more people about this event than the other's event, and you have low turnout, it means you're doing something right. So just to tell you a little bit about it, after last summer, and can everyone hear me or do we need to use mics? Everyone's perfect? Okay. So after last summer, a lot of people felt like forums are great, but wouldn't it be better if we did more? And a lot of those are the participants here today. So after last summer and doing so many bike forums, I came back and said, okay, I want to do another three. And everyone said, wait, we understand that each one of these forums might take an hour, but we'd rather do something that we think will actually make the street safer. So we actually all got together, and so NYPD, the 19th Precinct, and Chief Chan, who works with Chief Bratton, came together with us, with DOT, and we came together with Citi Bike, and we came together with Bike New York and Transportation Alternatives, and everyone agreed to put in dozens, if not hundreds of hours of work to make it safer for pedestrians and for cyclists on our streets this summer, because this is when people really use bicycles the most. We've done so much. So just to take a step back, as soon as I got elected, we worked with DOT to identify every dangerous intersection in the neighborhood. We sent a mailing to 60,000 households, and we took that information, we compiled that into a dangerous intersections report. We released that as part of our Livable Streets initiative, and we gave that to DOT. DOT came back with a Manhattan pedestrian safety plan that prioritized 1st Avenue, 2nd Avenue, 3rd Avenue, and between, I believe, 6 to 10 intersections that they prioritized as dangerous intersections that needed more attention. So people have started to notice that we have wider sidewalks, bulbs in certain places. On 86th Street, if you're having trouble getting across at 1st Avenue, now there's an island for you, and you're starting to see those creep up. These are part of physical infrastructure changes we are making to the city to make it safer for pedestrians and cyclists and vehicles and motor vehicles so that there are fewer collisions and fewer places where people are in conflict. So in addition to that, we also have some behavior problems. So some pedestrians are jaywalking and aren't looking both ways. Some cyclists aren't obeying all the rules. And as a result, we have to do something about it. And so the big thing we can do is education. And so a lot of people say, let's build more prisons. I say, let's build more schools. Because if we educate people, we can get them to behave better, not to engage in those behaviors. So we're able to get together. And so I just want to acknowledge Chief Chan at NYPD, as well as Captain Ted Fedorov, Detective Martin Green, Officer Alvarez, who will be with us here tonight. DOT, we have our Commissioner Polly Trottenberg, as well as Manhattan Borough Commissioner Margaret Forgione and Deputy Commissioner Nina Heyman, as well as Josh Orzik, who we work with closely on trying to fix every single pothole, make sure our streets are running, 600 miles of them. It's not a small task. Also, Transportation Alternatives, their Executive Director Paul White, Tom DeVito, Ali Oliver, who's here with us tonight, Bike New York. They're absolutely huge. I do the Bike New York 5-Borough Bike Tour every year. I recommend it to everyone. 32,000 people get to do a closed bike run, and that raises money to do education. So you can actually come to my district office or bike shops all over the district where they are teaching people who are new to biking or joining or interested in joining Citi Bike and others. And actually, also, I want to acknowledge Citi Bike, their executive director, Jay Walder, and Krasner, Danny Simons, who's here tonight. And we're actually doing something innovative, which is, as we just agreed on all the stations we're rolling out with DOT, Citi Bike will be here hopefully this September or sooner, but hopefully not later than September, and people will be here on bikes. And one of the things we approached Citi Bike and Bike New York about is, what can we do to make sure that anyone getting on a Citi Bike is a safe cyclist, as a safe rider. And so they'll tell you a little bit about some of the signage on every single Citi bike. But if you come to my district office, as well as anywhere that Citi Bike offers this program, Bike New York will train people in a 90-minute class on how to use Citi Bike and how to be safe riders in exchange for a free 24-hour day pass. And that's a way of making sure that people who are getting on these bicycles have an opportunity to learn. So we have this bike safety program, and so some key items that we launched this June is we give away free lights and bells in bike lanes. So that's a very positive moment to first have DOT personnel and volunteers out in the bike lanes, and we give them a light and a bell, and we use that moment to give them a bike map, to talk to them about the rules of the road and how important it is for them to observe rules like not running red lights and not riding up on sidewalks and giving right-of-ways to pedestrians. We also do another item which we launched last year. Has anyone here ever ordered takeout? That we're the Upper East Side, that's what's for dinner. A lot of the cyclists that we see are commercial cyclists. And so what we did is we launched a program with DOT to educate folks that any commercial cyclist should be wearing a vest and have lights and a bell, and they have to be observing the rules. And if the person is wearing a vest and they break those rules, you should be able to see the name of the restaurant and a clear legible as well as the number. Call that into 311, and we actually worked with 311 so you can start calling that in and call my office so that we can send somebody. If they're not wearing a vest, we can send a DOT inspector to go there and make sure. We actually are doing once a year, every year, a outreach to all the restaurants in my neighborhood and making sure that they know about the vest. We give them a free vest, we give them a bell, we give them a light, and we give them the training, whatever language they need, so that their people can be identified. Once we can identify them, you can call 311 to say, hey, I'm not okay with these drivers, they're not safe, and DOT and NYPD can respond. Additionally, you're empowered to call them and say to them, you know what, I'm not gonna shop here. And if everyone in your building stopped shopping at a restaurant that had commercial drivers that weren't safe, they'd care. 500 customers gone like that, they care about that. And that's more powerful than any fine I can write or NYPD or DOT can. So that's another piece where we're empowering you to have a role in that process. So we're gonna be giving away the vests, lights, and bells to the restaurants again, and DOT will speak to that. We are also partnered with the NYPD, so we have auxiliary officers out on the street. Did anyone see an officer standing in a bike lane handing out flyers or calming this summer? Well, we were out there with them, and we'll hear more about all the things we did there. I also purchased 5 bicycles for the 19th precinct. We'll be doing a ribbon cutting on that very soon, and that'll get the officers on bikes in the bike lanes where they can engage in enforcement activities there, whether it's keeping the bike lanes from being blocked to talking to other folks. And they've also been doing a lot more enforcement. We also, as I mentioned, the free day membership for training on how to use and bike safely. And then we've been working with transportation alternatives on education and traffic calming, and with Bike New York, they also do free classes. They teach kids and adults how to ride bikes, and when they're teaching somebody, they're not just teaching them how to get up on the wheels, they're also teaching them how to obey the rules of the road. They also do a safety class in bike shops and our district office. So that's a little bit of a preview of what we're going to hear from. And so part of accountability means once I announce something, you have a right to know what happens. So all the people who've been participating in this and all of us who came together and came up with this plan are now going to present to you on what we've done, what we're doing, and what the results have been. And we hope you'll be happy. There's always going to be room for improvement. This is our first year doing it. Part of it is to build a culture and let people know that year in, year out, we're going to be out here. And change starts. It doesn't happen overnight, but it can happen. And hopefully the more you learn about it, you're able to share with other people. So I'd like to now ask Commissioner Forgione from the Department of Transportation to come up and give a presentation. And if we could please give her a warm Upper East Side welcome.
glad to be here, Commissioner from Manhattan. We've been very happy to work with the council member and all of our fellow agencies and nonprofits on improving safety on the streets, which is what it really comes down to. So I want to talk a little bit tonight. We've heard from this community and from others with the increase in cycling, you know, concerns about pedestrian safety and how it all fits in with our larger safety efforts. So as the council member mentioned, we've been doing a lot of education and outreach. We leave the enforcement to NYPD, and they'll talk a little bit more about how they've really stepped up enforcement. But DOT has some sort of discrete role in really improving behavior of cyclists, of pedestrians, of drivers, everybody. So one thing that we've been doing a few years ago, we have a new commercial cycling law, which requires every delivery cyclist to have a vest on, which has a discrete number on the back, like 210 Joe's Pizza. So if you see the delivery cyclist, say, going the wrong way on the street in your neighborhood, and you know Joe's Pizza, you call them up and you say what you've seen. You also can decide not to frequent that spot, or you can call 311, and we send inspectors out. So they all need to have a vest. They all need to have a safe bicycle with a white light on the front and a red light on the back. The delivery cyclist must be wearing a helmet, and the bike itself must also have a sort of a little, almost like a license plate, but a little metal sign on the back which indicates where they're from. So I have, in the back, I've left a whole bunch of stuff, but there's a flyer that explains what the requirements for delivery cyclists are. So when we first, when the law first went into effect a few years ago, we visited every restaurant in Manhattan, basically, and we talked to them about what was required. And we had a grace period, and then after that grace period, we've issued thousands of summonses. And I don't have them broken down by council district, but it's something I'm working on getting so people can know what's happened within your neighborhood. But again, if you see a problem, what we do is we don't come and we just pick on Joe's Pizza. If you see a problem on, you know, 94th Street between 1st and 2nd, if you let us know, we will come out and we will sort of inspect all of those businesses to observe how they're behaving and what they're doing. So that's one thing we've done. But there's a lot of cyclists out there besides the delivery cyclists. And with the increase coming, with Citi Bike coming into the Upper East Side up to 86th Street this year, you know, we do hear a lot of concerns about pedestrian safety. So we hear cyclists riding the wrong way, riding on the sidewalks, running red lights. So we have done a lot working with NYPD, but also ourselves, to really better educate cyclists on what they need to be doing. One effort was yesterday with the council member. We're doing this all around town, is intervening with cyclists. Everyone loves something free, so we'll give them a free bell, sometimes free helmets, free lights. And when we put on the lights and the bells, we do it very slowly. We could do it in 10 seconds, but we drag it out. We make it like 5 minutes, and we give them a whole speech and discussion while we're putting it on, reminding people of what to do. We also have street safety ambassadors who are out on the road. These are people who actually are present in bike lanes and on sidewalks, and they remind pedestrians, cyclists of how they need to behave. So, you know, it's New York, so we don't want to get in somebody's face and start arguing, right? We don't want a big altercation, but what we do is we gently remind cyclists, hey, you're going the wrong way, and we try to call them over and talk with them. Pedestrians, listen, we're at fault too. We all need to be a little bit more responsible. We often see pedestrians, I'm guilty myself at times, you know, on your device and you're walking, and you need to be aware too. So we remind pedestrians of what their responsibilities are. And then of course, as part of our Vision Zero efforts, we've been doing a lot of outreach to drivers and a lot of enforcement. This is something we have in the back as well, reminding drivers of what they need to do. But again, it's all really, everybody needs to be part of the solution, the drivers, the pedestrians, and the cyclists. One other thing I wanted to mention, as you know, New York City has really changed over the last 5 or more years. You see a lot more bike lanes, you see a lot more plazas. We have, you know, people have mixed feelings about them, but what I want to really remind people and emphasize is that even if you're not a cyclist, and even if you're not so thrilled but with the cycling, you know, movement and the increase in cycling, the parking protected bike lanes are actually making the street safer for every single person on it. It's making it safer for the bikes, it's making it safer for the pedestrians crossing the streets, and also for the drivers navigating the streets. So I have a few statistics. Just for Manhattan, you know, obviously we have lanes on 1st Avenue, 2nd Avenue, 8th and 9th Avenues. Over a period of time that we've had these parking protected bike lanes, we've seen a decrease in crashes with injuries. Okay, so these are crashes that are vehicle on vehicle, vehicle on pedestrian, vehicle on cyclist. So it covers the whole gamut of all the kinds of crashes that we have. And it can, the improvement or the reduction in crashes can range anywhere from a reduction by 6%, which was 1st Avenue at 33rd Street, to as high as a reduction of 43%, which is on 9th Avenue in the section between 16th and 33rd Streets. And then as well, what goes along with that is the change in total injuries has decreased anywhere from 7% on these avenues up to 46%. So when we come out before we implement a parking protected lane, we often hear from people that are concerned about the bikes. But as a pedestrian, what it does is if you have that island that's about a third of the way into the street, you cross the bike lane, so you look for the bike, and you look both ways in case somebody's doing the wrong thing, and then you get a third of the way across the street on an island. So if you're a slower pedestrian, if you're a senior, if you have kids with you, and you don't want to cross in one signal cycle, you can wait there, wait for a fresh pedestrian walk signal, and then you can just keep going. And so that reduces the crossing distance, and it makes it much safer. So that's the key improvement for pedestrians, and obviously we have the improvement for the cyclists as well. So I have copies of this if anybody's interested. I also have materials at the back, and I think with that I'll end, and I'm happy to take questions afterwards. I think we're going for everything. Thank you.
Yes. We could give Mr. Boyd one key item. As folks are speaking, please make sure to write down your questions on cards. You can take as many cards as you like. What we'll do at the end of the presentations is go through the cards, group the cards that are similar together, do our best to either read through all of them or give one that summarizes all of them, and then ask the different panelists. If you have a question specifically for one specific person, make sure to indicate that on the card and raise your hand if you need a card. The next person I'd like to bring up is Officer Alvarez from the 19th Precinct, if we could give him a warm welcome.
All right. Hi, everybody. I'm Officer Alvarez from the 19th Precinct. I'm the Crime Prevention Officer of the 19th. I'm one of the three Community Affairs Officers in the 19th Precinct. Pretty much, like as Ben was saying, our job is to educate, but not only educate, but unfortunately we have to enforce some of the bike rules, some of the issues that we have. And we actually heard from you, so we appreciate Ben actually allowing us to be part of this education, this partnership that we had. So I'm going to throw out some numbers that we've had. We hope that you like them, because we sure do. And if you have any questions, like I said, just write them down. If I'm throwing out the numbers too quickly, just let me know and I'll slow down. So the best part about it is that we've actually, our pedestrian injuries and our bicycle injuries have gone down for year to date. They've gone down 15%. We've got actually gone down 18% in regards to pedestrian collisions. And we believe that's due to our enforcement. Our enforcement activity for year to date is actually up 52%. So we've definitely increased our enforcement because we've heard that, you know, we wanted to, you know, educate, but not only we want to reduce pedestrian injuries. So we've done numerous things. We've had a lot of help with obviously our auxiliary police officers, other units, citywide traffic task force. Our auxiliaries have helped us a lot. I just know in the month of June, just to throw out one month, they helped us out June, July, as well as in August, but I'll just throw out one month. We've handed out handed out 2,500 flyers on First Avenue. They were out with our auxiliary coordinator, they helped us out there. So that's just that. In August, we are told we have, I think we're up to maybe 8,000 flyers that we've handed out within the 2 month period. We've solely, just our precinct has handed out 4,600 of them. That's with help from the auxiliaries as well as, so the DOT has helped us out as well, handing out flyers. So now go to the best part, the guys you guys want to hear, enforcement activity. On June, when we first started, in June, I think our first day was June 8th, we've actually handed out, just our precinct alone, 50 summonses within a 3-hour period. We had 25 red light summonses, people taking red lights. We had 16 wrong way bicyclists driving the wrong way. In total, that day, with us as well as Citywide Traffic Task Force, we handed out 94 summonses within that 3-hour period. It's true, 94 summonses. That's an increase on that. That's on one day. On the next day, which was June 22nd, that total day we handed out 60 summonses. We had 16 of them going the wrong way, and 8 of them taking red lights, disobeying the traffic lights. So we've done that. On July 23rd, a total of 62 summonses were given out that specific day, where 25 of them were for red lights, and 23 were for the bicyclists going the wrong way. These are just solely just us issuing summonses to bicyclists, nobody else. And on August 7th, we only did enforcement for 2 hours, and that was 5 red lights and 3 failure to yield to pedestrians. So we believe that the enforcement activity that we've done helped reduce, we definitely lowered our collisions. Pedestrians, we haven't had anyone really seriously injured. Like I said, we're down 15% on bicycle injuries, as well as we're down 18% in regards to pedestrian injuries. So we believe that that's obviously in a partnership with this. If you guys have any further questions for me, feel free to jot it down. I'm more than happy to answer any specific questions that you may have. All right, thank you.
Thank you to the 19th Precinct and for traffic and DOT and their partnership. And again, one thing you should know is all of that enforcement was coupled with education. So before anyone got one of those tickets, they had a DOT person there with a light and a bell giving it to them. Hopefully we got them. They had police auxiliary officers educating them, engaging and giving them verbal warnings, handing out literature with information on how to enforce the rules and what the rules of the road were. So we're trying to couple education and enforcement. So the next group I'd like to bring up is Bike New York, Ken Podziba, if we can give him a warm welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I want to give you a little bit of an understanding of what Bike New York does, and then I'll dive right into what we're doing in this council district and for the bike safety program. So Bike New York is a 501c3 not-for-profit. It's been around since 2000, but it's only been in recent years that we really took off our education program. We educate over 16,000 people in bike education. We've become the largest provider of bike education in the country and probably the world. What we do is we have basically 12 centers around the 5 boroughs of New York City, and it's basically, we call them community bike education centers, but they're these big shipping containers. We fill them with bikes, with helmets, with supplies, and we have people come to us in parks. We used to be in schools also, but now we're just in parks around the city. And we have instructors, and the secret to our success is we have a network of over 3,000 volunteers who love our mission, love what we do, who come out and they volunteer their time to help educate people. Our largest classes by far are the adult and children's Learn to Ride program. And if you haven't volunteered for that, I recommend that you do. It's really quite amazing to be with someone in that pivotal moment in their lives when they don't think they could ride, especially adults because they have a lot of baggage and they don't think they could ride, and when they could do it, it feels so good and so awesome. So it's my favorite thing to do at Bike New York, so I recommend that. We have 14 different classes. We have in-school classes, we have after-school classes. We have a great summer camp program, 1,700 underserved kids. We teach them how to ride, we take them to zoos, ecology centers, museums, we teach them yoga, and it's really been a great program that we want to continue and expand. And we're at the point where, we want to expand, but we don't have the resources, and council members are helping to fund it, like your great council member here, so we hope to keep growing. We teach classes in Spanish. We plan to go into other languages. We started teaching classes at juvenile detention centers. We try to go after the most vulnerable populations, people with disabilities we've been teaching. And it's been a really terrific, robust programs. In this district, we educated so far this year over 1,100 people. And primarily because we have a community bike education center here in Roosevelt Island, and it's been fantastic. Not only do we have outdoor classes, but they gave us a big gym, so we have indoor classes as well. So all winter long, we've been having programs in there. There's summer camp, there's after school programs. We've really forged a great relationship with the residents there. We came to the Upper East Side primarily because we've been so impressed with Councilmember Kallos and this initiative, and we're excited to be part of it. We've been teaching classes in his office, at bike shops. We want to do the right thing. We care about bike safety. We don't pretend to have all the answers. So I'm really looking forward to hearing what you guys have to say. We're very adaptive. Somebody came up to me and said, you know, I like your classes, but I'm afraid to go to a bike shop and buy a bike because I'm intimidated. And I went in there and I didn't know what I wanted. I thought they were trying to sell me something I didn't need. So we developed a class called How to Buy a Bike. And it's one of our more popular classes. So if we see a need out there, we have the instructors, we have the volunteers, we could help make it happen. So just communicate with us, communicate with Councilmember Kallos, and we'll do our best to be part of the solution. One of the things we do, you know, there's good and bad in every group, so we don't pretend that all cycles are perfect. And one of the things we do is, when we have people in our classes, we encourage them to be role models, to try to change the culture, to go out there and if you see something, say something. If someone's going the wrong way, going through a red light, don't be silent. And I see too many New Yorkers who aren't shy by nature not speaking up enough. And I'm sure it's a vocal group here, but not enough people speak up. And that's what's needed. We need to change the culture. I was in Tokyo recently, and on the plane I was reading about the bicycling culture there, and I was astonished to read that people ride on the sidewalks, and it's part of everyday life in Tokyo, and they're more densely populated than New York. Like, how does that work? Couldn't wait to get off the plane and check it out myself. And sure enough, people ride on the sidewalks, and believe it or not, it worked because they had so much respect for each other. They would walk their bikes if it was busy. They would ride slowly. They were very respectful of people. So if we just learn to respect each other, you know, all the rules in the world and all the education in the world isn't going to, you know, do it. We need to change the culture, and that's what we're trying to do with Bike New York. We're trying to convince people to be part of that solution. So that's it for me, and I look forward to hearing your questions later. Thank you.
Just want to thank Bike New York. A lot of this program came from Bike New York and DOT. Bike New York came to a couple of our programs, their director of education, Richard Conroy, and they said, let's engage, let's do this education. So 1,100, that's actually 0.5% of my district. That's a lot of people. That's a lot of people in this neighborhood who have been taught how to ride a cycle, how to respect the rules, how to obey red lights, and making sure that people who are buying new bikes are being offered an opportunity, a free opportunity, courtesy of Bike New York, to learn how to obey those rules. It's astounding, it's amazing. I don't give them as much funding as they provide services to our district. And that being said, if anyone knows anyone that needs to learn how to ride a bike or might want to buy, or kids or whatever, they do a free program in schools and we're happy to bring them out, but we're so very lucky to have them. I'd like to now have Danny Simons from Citi Bike come out and tell you a little bit about it. One thing I just want to say about Citi Bike is right now below 59th Street, it's just another form of public transportation. You can use Citi Bike to get across town faster than you can on a bus or a subway. And when it comes, it means that your commute should get better. Because if you want to get somewhere quicker on the Upper East Side, you'll be able to hop on a Citi Bike. If you want to take the bus, fewer people are going to be on that bus because they'll be on Citi Bikes. If you want to get on that 456 or something like that, you're going to get where you want to faster. Some of the cars in the neighborhood may not be there either because people will be hopping on the city bikes because they're very convenient. For people who live here in NYCHA, I believe the rate is $99 a year.
$60.
Sorry, $60 a year. If you are just a regular person who wants a one-year subscription, it's $149.
Yeah.
And so it's a great program. We also engaged in a very long deliberative process with the community on selecting each bike station. So thousands of people got to have a say in where they went. We actually moved multiple bike stations. And we had a lot of people who wrote in and said, dear Councilmember Kallos, dear Commissioner Forgione, thank you for listening to us. Thank you for having a public forum. Thank you for taking feedback online. Thank you for emailing us copies of the maps ahead of time. We mailed it out to about 60,000 people seeking feedback, and we were able to make accommodations and find the best places. So we're hoping that the system that we get is something that everyone can use and that benefits the community. And thank you.
Thank you. I want to thank Councilmember Kallos for his great support of City Bike and of bike safety in general and bicycling in New York in general. I want to thank our partners at the New York City Department of Transportation. They are making the streets safer every day and also helping us make this a great City Bike program. And I'd love to give thanks also, and I mean, you can't hear Ken talk and hear his passion and hear all the amazing work that Bike New York is doing without being so impressed and overwhelmed and just grateful that for his energy and for his organization and for all of the great things that they're bringing to the city and helping people get involved in cycling and learn how to ride even though maybe your parents didn't know or maybe your parents' parents didn't know, and really giving people the opportunity to get around in a different way and get some healthy exercise along the way. I am here representing City Bike. I am super excited because I'm here at a time when we are finally expanding the City Bike program. City Bike launched in May of 2013. We launched with 6,000 bikes at 332 stations. And this year we are beginning an expansion that will double the size of the program by the end of 2017, taking us to about a little over 700 stations and a little over 12,000 bikes. We kicked that off at the beginning of August in Queens, and we are about halfway through our expansion in Brooklyn and Queens. So we've installed about close to 50 stations over the last 2 weeks in Long Island City, Greenpoint, Williamsburg, and we'll be heading into Bed-Stuy tomorrow, assuming that the weather stays okay. And then after that, we'll be coming to the Upper East and Upper West Sides in September. We'll be installing stations north to 86th Street this year, and we'll continue on, and the program will expand into Harlem by the time we're done doubling the size of the program by 2017. I want to just talk a little bit tonight, because the topic is safety, about what we do to encourage safety. It's very important to all of us. It's very, very important to me. I think that it's essential that our customers ride safely and respectfully, and as to Ken's point, are sort of part of creating this culture of respect on the streets of New York City. I think the first thing to note is that all of our materials have the four cardinal rules of bike safety in New York. Rules and laws are complicated and long, and if you can boil them down and make them simple, it's a lot easier for people to understand. Ours are yield to pedestrians, stay off the sidewalk, ride with traffic, and obey traffic lights. You follow those rules as a cyclist, we believe that you will be safe and you'll also be helping keep others on the road safe. So those rules are printed on things like the brochures that we hand out to promote the program to begin with. They're printed on our website. They're sent to every member when they sign up for City Bike for the first time. They're printed on the station kiosks, and they're even printed on the bikes themselves. So if you look down at a set of City Bike handlebars, this is what you'll see. The rules are printed there for you to read every time you take out a bike, and they're printed in both English and Spanish. Beyond just that, we also partner with Bike New York, and we offer what are called City Bike Street Skills classes. They're free classes available to anyone. We've worked with Councilmember Kallos to schedule some in this district. We're trying to hold classes in all of the areas where we're expanding and kind of hold more classes as we get new stations down, and we know that there'll be interest there. If you attend the classes, you get a free 24-hour pass to experience the City Bike system and try it out for yourself. Tell your friends if they want a chance to try City Bike and learn some bike safety. It's a great investment of an hour or two of your time.
And we try to partner with other organizations as well to continue to promote bike safety, and you'll hear from the folks at Transportation Alternatives in a little bit, and we really support the work that they do as well to help bring bike safety to more New Yorkers. We promote safety in a lot of other ways as well. We have a very robust social media following. We're very lucky to have large followings on Twitter and Facebook, and I will say that I tell my staff, when there's nothing else to say, send a safety tip. And so, you know, we program those in advance, and probably somewhere between 5 to 10 times a week, we are sending out safety tips, and people retweet them again and again and again. It's a very popular way and an easy way for us to help continue to spread the word. Safety is fundamental to what we're doing. We can't really have bike share without safety. We want all of our riders to be safe. We want all of you to be safe. And so far, with over 20 million trips, I'm very proud that we've had a very robust safety record. And we hope to continue that through the partnership with all the folks in this room and with your support. So thank you very much.
So our program's moving right along. We're hoping to try to get things done with presentations by 8 o'clock, and then hopefully have the Q&A session done and get everyone, get your questions answered. So please, if you have a card with a question already written on it, you can hand it in and back, or you can hold the card up and we'll collect it from you. If you still haven't had a chance to write your question, now's the time to try to get it in before the last speaker. During the last speaker, we'll be reviewing your questions and making sure we get them all in. We're going to be holding it for bike-related questions, bike safety-related questions only. And just so you know, the first Friday of every month, 8 a.m. to 10 a.m., I'm happy to have a conversation with you about whatever you want. We have dozens of people every single month. If you have an idea for changing a law that's not related to bicycles or things like that, we have a policy night, second Tuesday of every month at 6 p.m. I'm happy to have a conversation with you. And so I'd like to invite Ali Oliver from Transportation Alternatives.
Thank you, council member. It's really exciting to be here. So Transportation Alternatives is a nonprofit. We've been working to make New York City streets safer for over 40 years. We work in all 5 boroughs, and we work for better engineering, better street design. We work for educating all street users on the best way to get around, and we advocate for laws that protect vulnerable street users like pedestrians and people riding their bikes. So earlier the DOT was talking about protected bike lanes. That's the bike lane next to the sidewalk, separated from moving car traffic by parked cars or sometimes flexible plastic barriers. And that is some of the most exciting infrastructure that you're going to see anywhere in America. It came to New York City first, in part because of Transportation Alternatives efforts. And the great thing about parking protected bike lanes is that they make it safer for people walking. And one of the ways they make it safer for people walking is by providing a turning bay for motor vehicles and separated signals for motor vehicles. At Transportation Alternatives, we like to say that pedestrians are kings and queens of New York City streets. Pedestrians almost always have the right of way. I would say always have the right of way. And that needs to be respected. One of the things we do in related to bikes, because this is a bike safety forum, is we hand out thousands of biking rules every year. And right inside the front cover, you can see this is a diagram trying to break down who should yield to who. And as you can see, people riding their bikes and people driving are both supposed to yield to the kings and queens of New York City streets, our pedestrians, our people walking. Because we all walk for part of our trip. I walk from my house to the curb where I parked my bicycle. I walk from my house to the subway. I walk from my house to a taxi cab or car if that's the way I'm getting around that day. So no matter what way you're getting around the city, you have to walk for part of your trip. Making it safer for people walking makes it safer for all of us. I also receive a lot of complaints about bad bicycle behavior, and people want to know what can I do to prevent people behaving badly on bicycles in my neighborhood. The two most common complaints I think I get are riding on the sidewalk and running red lights. The great news about riding on the sidewalk is that protected bike lanes have been shown to reduce sidewalk riding by up to 81%. That's in New York City along Prospect Park West. We've seen 81% reduction in sidewalk riding after a safe place to ride your bike, where you're supposed to. If you give someone a place where they're supposed to ride their bike on the street, they're much, much more likely to ride their bike there. If you change the timing of the lights to accommodate slower traffic, and that's everyone, people riding bikes and people driving. If everyone using the street slows down a little bit, it's going to be much safer for everyone. And if people riding bikes encounter more green lights than they encounter red lights, they're much more likely to obey the signal that's in front of them. Now, that does not excuse riding on the sidewalk when there isn't a protected bike lane. That does not excuse going through a red light when you encounter a lot of red lights in your commute. Being impatient is not an excuse for bad behavior that puts other people in danger. But there are engineering steps that we can take. Along with those protected bike lanes also comes separated signals. Columbus Avenue, 9th Avenue, I know has these. They might be other places around the city. There are exclusive phases for people walking. If you've ever had the crosswalk signal and felt like you had to cross like this in order to be safe because of turning vehicles, whether that vehicle is a car or a bicycle, you know what I'm talking about. There are places where it's an exclusive phase just for people to walk across the street, and that's easier to do with a protected bike lane because they separate out turning cars straight through bicycle traffic and vehicle traffic and people walking. They line that all up so that there's no turning conflicts for people trying to cross the street. So Transportation Alternatives really believes that engineering is one of the strongest ways you can encourage good behavior. Right now, a lot of our streets, if you look at 5th and 6th Avenue, 2nd Avenue above a certain point doesn't have its protected bike lane like its mate, 1st Avenue. It's much harder for people to cross the street on 2nd Avenue, at least it is in my experience. 2nd Avenue is a wide street with a lot of space dedicated to driving or parking people's private automobiles. When we dedicate more space to people walking and people biking, those people walking and people biking are more likely to behave better because they're no longer fighting each other for the scraps of street space that they've been given. If we dedicate space for all types of users, all types of users can behave the way they're supposed to rather than feeling like they're on the fringes. Education is very important. One thing Transportation Alternatives does is back up the DOT's wonderful working cyclist program. And we go into restaurants and we provide each of their delivery cyclists with their rights and responsibilities as cyclists in the form of biking rules. We give them a free set of bike lights so that it's easier to see them. We make sure that we talk to the owner or manager and tell them that they need to give their delivery cyclists enough reasonable time to make their deliveries. If they're getting pressure from their boss, if they feel like they're gonna lose their job if they don't make a delivery in time, they're gonna make dangerous shortcuts. That is going to be bad for them, it's gonna put themselves in danger, and it's gonna put people walking in danger. And none of us want that. These guys work really hard in all kinds of weather. When do you order takeout the most? The council member mentioned it earlier. When it's raining, right? When the snow is coming down. When you don't want to be outside. And so you're encouraging someone to get on a bicycle and bring your food to you because the weather is poor. So we need to adjust our expectations on the kind of speed we want that person taking when they're making a delivery. And that's one of the conversations I have with restaurant owners is about giving their delivery guys a safe bicycle and a safe amount of time to make a delivery. If you make it possible for people to behave better, it's more likely that they'll behave better. And then enforcement is the third leg that can keep us all safe out on New York City streets. And Transportation Alternatives has lobbied to pass laws that keep people walking or riding their bikes safer, such as a lower speed limit and an increased amount of automated enforcement for that speed limit. Speeding and failure to yield by motor vehicles are the two leading causes of injuries in traffic in New York City. And by lowering the speed limit, you increase stopping time, you make it more likely that there won't be a crash in the first place. And that's one of the best ways to keep everyone safe, is to slow down and respect each other, which a couple of other presenters have mentioned. And Transportation Alternatives really wants to make that possible through engineering, through street redesign, education, and when those two fall short, enforcement. And it's 8 o'clock.
Thank you to all of our presenters for moving right along and giving brief, concise, and informative presentations. So we have all the questions in. A couple of folks want to share information, and I've read those comments. I'm hoping that they were there for me. And I think a lot of people have had experiences. One of the comments was about somebody feeling that they've almost been hit by a vehicle. Some people have almost been hit, some people have been hit. And I think everything we're trying to do is to make that less and less likely. And I think from some of the information we heard today, it is actually less likely today for you to be hit by a vehicle or a cycle than it was a year ago or before these pieces. So the first one I'll go over is, this one I'll bring DOT up for the first sets of questions. Commissioner Forgione, if you'll join me up here. Will the East River SMLA be getting repaved anytime soon, 96th to 125th Street? And if you can come a little bit further in frame. Damaged and crumbling cement causes me to have several flat tires. Also, lights are out along the East River Park waste transfer station. It's the hill by Gracie Mansion. So there's an incline from 91st to 90th Street by Gracie Mansion, and the lights are out. Can we do something about that?
So DOT maintains all the lighting in the city, on city streets, as well as within the parks. So East River Esplanade is Parks Department jurisdiction, so the pavement issue would go to them. But we are responsible for the lights, and we do know we've had a lot of lights out for a while. The lights were damaged and sandy, and you know, to compound the problem on the East River Esplanade, we also have areas of severe undermining of the bulkhead wall. So we have portions that are sort of scraped out and water is getting in and undermining the Esplanade, and Parks is taking the lead of those repairs, but we are working with them, and we are working on the sandy repairs, which actually entail a total replacement of the conduit in that area.
And the next, but for the lights, we'll be able to fix the ones on Gracie Hill?
In particular, we're working on all of them.
Perfect. Yeah. Next question, are there plans for a bike lane on 2nd Avenue when the subway construction ends, all the way from 125th Street to 1st Street, and I will add, will that be a protected lane?
The answer is yes, and mostly yes. So as the 2nd Avenue subway restores station by station, what we'll be doing is we'll be coming to Community Board 8 and Community Board 11, we're okay up in 11, mostly Community Board 8, to review the design of the bike lane. So the bike lane will be parking protected as it is throughout, but in the area approaching the Queensboro Bridge, we're probably not going to have it parking protected right up to the bridge due to the volumes of traffic. So there'll be a small number of streets that will probably be shared lanes leading to 59th Street. But little by little, and starting late this year, or probably more likely next year, as the MTA restores the area, we'll start getting our parking protected bike path.
This is a question that we may also have NYPD answer later, but this is directed to you from Robert. Why aren't the bike safety flyers being handed out specifically to bicycle safety? The Vision Zero flyer seems to be too general. And I think along the same lines, and I got this feedback at a policy night where somebody looked at the flyers, they were really glad to see them being handed out, but they were hoping to see the same four rules of the road that City Bike has on their bikes visually and more apparent in what is being handed out.
Okay, we have a ton of materials, and I only brought a certain amount of them, but we have a brochure that's similar to the one that Transportation Alternatives just showed, Ellie held in his hand. It's called Bike Smart. We have it in 6 or 7 languages, and it's probably about a 10-page brochure. In the beginning, it summarizes the rules of the road, and then it goes into it in more depth. And we give out tens of thousands of those a year, and that's really our material that we try to get into the hands of cyclists. So we have like all kinds of material. So the Vision Zero flyer is a very general one. We knock on windows when cars are stopped at red lights and we hand one in. We hand them to pedestrians walking by. They're not an in-depth tool. It's just sort of a quick alert to different pedestrians, cyclists, and drivers. So we really rely on the more in-depth material to get the message through.
So I'm going to ask Citi Bike to come up and join DOT, and we'll just answer two similar questions that we got relating to the expansion of, I guess, bike lanes and Citi Bike. So it is just a concern about the expansion and about having so many bicycles in an overpopulated city. So I will pass it on for folks to read, and if you want to take a moment to answer those questions.
Yeah, I'll say two things. One is that in New York, it has proven out, and in other big cities around the world, people have seen actually a safety in numbers effect with people bicycling. So what's been shown is that the more people bicycling, the safer the streets become, and the per capita injury and fatality rate drops, and that's been shown here in the data over the last 10 years in New York City. So I actually believe that the more people riding bikes, the safer the streets become. And it's not, I think it's proven out, if you know, when you're in Manhattan, South 59th Street, there was a lot of predictions when Citi Bike first launched that it would somehow cause chaos and mayhem and madness, and that just hasn't proven out at all. It's been just a normal part of the transportation network now, and it's just a normal way that people get around. And I will say, you know, people have different feelings about the program expanding. I will say, by and large, what we've heard over the last many years, the last 2 years, we haven't been able to expand, was repeated calls and requests for like, when are you coming here? When are you coming here? We literally get hundreds of emails a week from people asking like, when are you going to be on the Upper East Side? When are you going to be on the Upper West Side? And for me tonight, I mean, this is my personal experience, so it's not necessarily yours, but I had probably a 10 to 15 minute walk here from the subway. I could have been here in like 4 minutes if there was Citi Bike here. And so I think, you know, I would say give it a try, see how it goes. New things are definitely, you know, it's an adjustment. I get nervous when new things happen in my neighborhood as well. But I think that you'll see that it provides a little extra convenience. You don't have to ride it to work. You don't have to want to take like a 3 hour bike ride. Like, it really just becomes a more convenient way to get somewhere than it can replace a walking trip. It replaces when your bus isn't coming on time. It just makes things that much easier. And I say, you know, try it and see it, and we'll be working closely with the DOT and with your council member to make sure that it's working well and that it's not causing mayhem and disruption in your neighborhood.
Okay, thank you very much. The next questions are going to be on education. So I'd like Ken from Bike New York to come up. Would you like the hard question or the easy question first? They're both hard.
Give me the hard one then.
The hard one. Are there any inexpensive bike repair shops in this area?
There are. The least expensive place to get your bike repaired is on Roosevelt Island, because Bike New York provides free bike maintenance on weekends. You go to our website, bike.nyc, and you'll see when we offer it. Also, there's
is this only for people who came to this forum or who mentioned Ben Kallos or anybody?
You got to mention Ben Kallos, and it's free. If you need a tune-up or anything light, we'll do for free. If it's more extensive, we'll recommend that you go to a bike shop. But if you're going to a bike shop and you want to save a little money, there's Recycle a Bicycle is a not-for-profit that has a couple of bike shops in the city, one in the East Village on Avenue C and the other in Dumbo. You can save a little money, and it's great, but we also want you to support your local bike shops here. They don't make as much money as most people think. They're barely making ends meet, and we just encourage you to support your local bike retailer.
Okay, tough question from Robert. Tougher than the last one.
Okay.
Bike education is important, but if everybody is quote unquote doing it, red lights wrong way, on the sidewalk, why bother?
Why bother? Because we can't give up. That's what we do every day. We try to teach people bike safety, and as I said before, it's a culture change. I don't know how many people here remember were around in the 70s when Mayor Koch developed this Cooper Scooper law. No one thought it would ever work because the police can't be everywhere and they can't enforce it. But the people enforced it. when people didn't pick up after their dogs, people were screaming, you know, you pick up after your dog, and now it's unthinkable, you know, everyone picks up after their dog. If people impose that kind of pressure on cyclists, and again, it's most cyclists obey the rules and they're good, it's the minority that really are breaking the rules that we have to collectively come together and stamp out of the city and get them to change their behavior. You go to other places, you go to some other cities, and it's unthinkable to break the rules. And that's what we need here. We need a culture change, and it's only going to happen if we all come together and realize how much we love this city and we want to change. Thank you.
Thank you. So the rest of the questions everyone had were enforcement and NYPD related. So all these other folks who've been here worked all day. Their day started at 7, 6, even earlier. I'd like to let them all head out and excuse them and give them a round of applause and a hearty thank you.
Thank you.
So we're going to let them go. And now I'm going to ask our friend from the 19th precinct to come up. He's going to read through the questions, answer all of your questions that you gave. He got the bulk of them. I think that's about a dozen. Also, if you didn't have an enforcement question or if your questions are already been answered, now is your time to step out. I will not be offended. We're glad that you did come out, and we hope that we found this informative. I'll be listening for feedback on how to improve future forums. And again, thank you to all of our participants, and if you can stand right here, that will make sure that the folks who are watching at home online can keep up. Thank you so very much.
So the first question is, I'm going to kind of combine it with one. It says, how would you define unsafe riding? As well as, do you think bicycle confiscation impoundment should be an enforcement option?
So we would define unsafe riding as whatever the rules of the road would be.
We enforce the same as bicycles, the same as vehicles. So unsafe riding would be taking a red light. Unsafe riding would be going the wrong way on a sidewalk, things like that. Excessive speed. Now, as of right now, we don't really have a speed thing with bicycles. It's not a thing. But obviously, speed might be an issue. If somebody's coming 25 miles an hour, hits a pedestrian, whether or not the pedestrian's at fault is going to cause a lot of damage. So it's pretty much the same rules that we are enforcing as what we define unsafe riding. In regards to if I believe confiscation and impoundment will be an enforcement issue, I wouldn't have a personal opinion on it. Those would have to be laws that would have to change that allow us to enforce those. Do you want to jump in on that?
Actually, it's an option to confiscate someone's bicycle for riding on the sidewalk, isn't it?
On the sidewalk, yes. But not, we, to be honest, most of our submissive issues are actually not on the sidewalk. They're actually on the wrong way, red lights. So in regards to that, in just that time period, we issued 400 summonses in regards to that, and we issued 68 were on sidewalk. So out of those 400 and then 68. So most of our enforcement was on most of the issues that we've seen with people actually going the wrong way, taking the red lights, things of that nature. This is just more of a statement. I was almost hit twice yesterday by an overtaxed bicyclist. I was definitely obeying the crossing signals at the time. There's no question by it, but we are out there enforcing. There are dedicated units in the 19th precinct that are enforcing bicycle rules on a daily basis, as well as the outreach that we did do with the for these past 2 months.
Are these laws passed?
In regards to what, ma'am?
The bicycle rule. They enforce what? When they get a summons, do they have to go to court?
Yes. So every moving violation is just almost like you're getting a moving violation of a vehicle. You have to go to traffic court. The only difference is that right now there's no specific points on your license. The fines are still the same. So it's still, you know, $115, $120 summons, fine that you will get. The fines are exactly the same. Yeah. So whether you take a red light on a vehicle versus you take a red light on a bicycle, the fines are exactly the same. There's no difference. The only slight difference is that there's no physical points on your license because you're not operating the motor.
There's no points on your license for running a red light on a bicycle, and there's an $88 motor vehicle surcharge that applies to all motor vehicle tickets that bicycles do not pay. So your first red light offense is $190. That's on a bicycle. And then if you were in a motor vehicle, the additional $88 motor vehicle surcharge would bring that total to $278. So if you've ever gotten a red light while driving a car, you see that $278 total on the back. For a bicycle, it's actually $190.
This was a long question, so I'm just going to read it out. My impression is that there's an excess of focus on bicycle riding violations compared with auto violations. Considering that auto violations are the ones most likely to cause fatalities, both to bicycles and pedestrians, it seems that if a motorist hits a bicyclist or a pedestrian, it's always called an accident, unless the driver is drunk. What is being done to hold motorists more accountable for speeding and other unsafe driving practices, and more liable when they cause traffic accidents? Well, I believe it was last year that we actually changed the word accident all around. We actually don't call them accidents anymore. We call them collisions because we believe that they're all preventable. Accidents means that somebody that it wasn't preventable. We believe that all collisions are preventable. That's why we changed it forward. So whether it's a bicycle collision or auto collision, we still call it the same. It's just we classify it differently. So the numbers I have here are just the ones that I'm reading to you are just involving bicycles. I do have. Difference. I'll just you know, even though this is different, we've issued in that same year to date, we've issued 972 bicycle summonses. We issued 9,302 motor vehicle summonses. So we are also enforcing motor vehicles, which is like this question said. Yes, if you get hit by a motor vehicle, yes, it's a possibility that the injuries are going to be more. That's why their speed limit was reduced to try to aid in that. So it's pretty much four questions on, other than riding through red lights, wrong way on the sidewalk, without lights at night, attempting to evade, are there any more major bike offenses? That's pretty much most of them. We also have ones with cell phones, bicyclists on their cell phones.
It was my understanding it's not illegal to use a handheld device while riding your bicycle.
I have here, for some reason, bicycle mode on cell phone. They have 25, so it's a possibility that it is. You know, I don't know. Like I said, unfortunately, I don't write these summonses anymore. Different aspects, so I don't know. I'm not up to date. I'm just reading what's on the thing, on my notes.
The handheld device and operating while impaired laws specifically apply to. Motor vehicles, they say motor vehicle in the statute, uh-huh. And they're not supposed to be applied to bicycles. So not that it's a good idea to do either of those things on a bicycle.
We don't believe it is, but
just about what's able to be enforced.
Yes, so like I said, I can see that maybe that's why the numbers are so low. But, you know, both of our summonses are for one-way street, one way going the wrong way, not giving right of way to pedestrians, and disobeying study red signals. So that's those three. Are the bulk of the summonses that we issue.
I'll put
them
on the battery.
I'm sorry? Yeah, those are the last three are all similar. Are electric bikes legal? And if so, do they need a license to ride them? Are electric bikes illegal? If so, why don't I see them being confiscated? And the last one's on the brochure for delivery states operation of electric bikes is prohibited. Why are so many on our streets? Many are delivery people. So yes, electric bikes are illegal. They are not, they're not supposed to be riding at all. They're not supposed to even be on. Just like we don't see Segways, we're not supposed to see any type of electric type of vehicle on our roadways. Now, when we do encounter delivery riders using those, we do summons them for it, and we do impound them, because they're not supposed to have them. We try our best to... just because it's not illegal to own them, it's just illegal to ride them, at least in the state of New York. You know, it's illegal to ride them, they're not to, just like there's so many like ATVs, you really don't see them on our roadways, they sell them, and that's supposed to be on our roadways, but, you know, that you see, unfortunately, sometimes you see those that... I'm sorry?
Most deliveries?
Yeah, you do see, like, the delivery guys with them. It was when they first started coming out, we started our enforcement, because we have to also wait for the laws to actually pass. And go through so we can actually enforce those. We can't enforce, laws that don't exist.
on the wrong way. I don't have the actual summons things in front of me, but I there's just a similar, the same, like he was saying, it's just less than, you just don't have that surcharge, but it's, they're all over $107, you know, so. Any other questions for me?
Is there enforcement action for someone in the bike lane where cyclists and pedestrians go the wrong way in the bike lane?
Yeah, so the we had a specific, in one of my